I've been reading this lesson today. Because Joseph said, God, get me so to heal. God, someone just said, I'm jumping. God made y'all do this to me, brought me here, so that he could use me to save the nation Israel. Well, that must be right. It's in the Bible. Joseph said it. Okay, let me sit down and tell you some more stuff. Brother, it's because they fired you, and God's going to use that to get you to, because he's sitting this on you, and hallelujah. God's going to use this sickness to get some glory. Everybody shout amen. Everybody say amen. Okay. All right. So I start teaching this. I'm definitely in a minute. And then I go to the show.
What do you lay on?
When it said it in the Bible.
I think he's taking it better later on. He said what God meant.
All right. Let's get it right. Let's get it right. God does not have evil, sickness, none of that kind of stuff in his toolbox. He don't need it, and he don't use it, and he can't use it to bring you to him. No negative stuff can he use, like does he have, so for you to experience to bring you to him. What is it that God uses to get you to him? It's the goodness of God. Lead us to repent.
I'm trying to listen to what you say.
Okay.
Make it come all in.
All right. Now just listen. We got the lesson again. Another question for the class. What if Joseph had not been sold into slavery?
God's deal with
him.
You
want to
answer to that?
Mm-hmm. What if Joseph had not been sold into slavery?
God's deal with him. Skip the problem. So, I mean, maybe God just took us and used that avenue.
Okay. And then, coupled with that, God's plan, he has a plan, and if had it not been Joseph, it could have been someone else, because he has a plan.
And the plan was revealed to who? Joseph.
It was revealed to him in his dream. The plan was in place.
It was revealed to him. God going to use me and everybody else to bow down to me. I'm going to have dominion over y'all, bro. I'm going to have dominion over y'all and everybody else. And like that. Sold into slavery.
There was one thing Joseph never mentioned in those dreams was how he got from here to there.
That's right. And that's a good deal target toward at the end of the lesson we're going to get to, reconciliation. Because there's somebody in this story that Joseph never told his story to. A key player in this lesson who Joseph never told his story to. Joseph never told the full story to somebody. It's funny. Okay, we're going to see why. Okay, so let's go to our lesson, I suppose. Let's look at Joseph, his job. 41st chapter, verse 53. What was his job?
At the 7 years of consciousness that was in the land of Egypt were ended, and the 7 years of dearth began to come, according as Joseph had said. And the dirt was in all land, but in all the land of Egypt, there was bread.
That's the whole chapter. Yes, 41st chapter, she's in verse 55.
Yes, I'm in verse 55.
This is verse 55.
And in all the land of Egypt was famine, the people cried to Pharaoh for bread. And Pharaoh said unto all the Egyptians, go unto Joseph, what he saith to you, do.
Okay.
And the famine was over all the face of the earth. And Joseph opened all the storehouses and sold them to the Egyptians. And the famine waxed sore in the land of Egypt. Okay. And all countries came into Egypt to Joseph for to buy corn, because that the famine was so sore in all the land.
Okay, all right. Now here's Joseph. You know, his job. And actually, he is what I would call in today's term, a broker. He's a broker. Anybody that wants something, you gotta come to you, get it, you sell it to him. I wonder if Joseph got a little percentage of commerce that was going on.
He is a righteous man.
I'm righteous, but I ain't dumb.
But if one was supporting him, he did. But I don't think he took anything.
Pretty good.
The king obviously paid him very well anyway.
Yeah.
In a lot of respect.
So he didn't have to get anything under the
table. What do you think, Kurt? Businessman? Let me find a businessman over here.
They go get somebody else.
But according to Joseph's life,
it was right to get a piece of it, what we call action.
If it was afforded him.
Because they hadn't come to him.
Who had the dominion? Joseph.
Yeah.
He made the decision. It's not much of this out here. It's not much is going over here.
I think that's part of the mystery because, you know, as the king, I'm sure the king was paying him very well anyway, put him over all.
He gave him everything.
Yeah.
Gave
so
him
that's everything. Part of the mystery that we will.
Gave him everything anyway. He had dominion. Who makes the rules?
I mean, when the king gave him that authority, he gave him that authority also because he didn't want to have anything to do with it.
Right.
You dream this? This is your dream, you interpret it, you know what's going on. Okay, you enjoy it, I don't even want to worry about it. You take care of it.
So when God raised you up and given you authority, guess what? You got the authority. I'm going to show you something here in a minute, how God hates poverty. Oops. Hopefully, they don't pay me taxes. Okay, Romans 8:28. We're trying to get to our lesson. Romans 8:28. You could be mic'd there, Brother Curtis.
Yeah, I'm having a hard time probably.
You're stirring the pot.
I gotta get a cut.
Barely work something out here. Romans 8:28. What did it say there?
And you know that all things work together for good to them that love God, to them who are the called according to His purpose.
We know that all things are work together for our good, to them who are called according to His purpose. Joseph knew he was called. We know we're called, and we know everything, no matter what the adversity that you may be experiencing, it's going to all work out to your good. You know you've been called to salvation. Hallelujah. In a dungeon, in a jail, they lied on me and said, I tried to rape the man's wife. Well, I did rape the man's wife. Then I'm back in jail. I tried to tell the butler to remember me, and I got farther down in jail. Oh, my goodness. How is this? Is this going to ever work out for my good? What? How is it? And, yeah. Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah. You come out on top. You're going to come out on top. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Okay. All right, historical perspective. What's the size of Jacob's family about this time? Father. It's in the scripture.
70.
70, right? And it's backed up again in Acts 7:14. It's like, I think they get a little bit above 70 in Acts 7:14. A little bit above Acts 7:14. Okay, so now we're going to start in Genesis 45. If you get Acts 7:14, go ahead and read it. It's a real short scripture.
Then said Joseph.
Uh-huh. Okay, brother.
Then said Joseph and called his father Jacob to him and all his kindred, 75 souls.
Okay, so
75.
Okay. And the old man is 130 years old. All right, now we're going to go to our lesson today, Genesis 45. Let's get a little background on that. That's all we did. All right, now. And Joseph said unto his brethren, Genesis 45:3, Joseph said unto his brethren, I am Joseph, doeth my father yet live? And his brethren could not answer him, for they were troubled at his presence. And Joseph is dressed up in Egyptian garb, clothes, and everything that an Egyptian king would wear, and he appears to be 100% Egyptian. And how can you, I can only imagine the attire, the makeup, facial makeup, the things that they did back in that day. Back in that day, men wore earrings. They might have did a little makeup on the face, arch their eyebrows. And maybe you put a little deal on that lip. You're not a woman. Put a little stuff on.
If he was looking like that, the one is really
put stuff on. Egyptian clothing. I didn't come from over here where we would never see nobody dress up. So that's how they knew that he had. No, who is this guy? Who is this? And he said, does my father still live? Who is this? What do you mean? So, and that's why we get to verse 45 and 4. Go ahead and someone read that if you would, please.
Joseph said unto his brethren, come near to me, I pray you. And they came near, and he said, I am Joseph, your brother, whom you did wrong.
First part of getting it straight now is recognizing. You did wrong. You did me wrong. First part of reconciliation. You did me wrong. For God has reconciled us to God. First thing we got to do is say, I'm wrong. Then when you say, I'm wrong, then next step, repent. Okay, so that's the first deal about reconciliation. Recognizing you're wrong. That's what he did. He put it on whom you sold into slavery. Did me wrong. And now it's got to be the reconciliation, the forgiveness part. And that's, so Joseph has got to make a choice. I'm going to kill him, or either I'm going to forgive him. So Joseph has to make up in his mind, but I'm going to kill off the guild and reconcile. Now, don't be grieved means now don't be what? Scared. Don't be feeling sorry for you. No, don't be scared that I'm going to kill you. Someone read that if you will. The verse 5.
Now therefore be not grieved, nor angry with yourself that ye sold me hither. For God did send me before you to preserve life.
All right, that's what we did. We get that straight now, interpretation of that scripture as the first of the class. Joseph said it. Must be right.
Yeah, but we also established that if they had told him, that was sent to Egypt anyway.
Yeah.
So.
So
Joseph is saying, you did me wrong, I wound up here, and it appears as he's thinking that God made you sell me into slavery so that I could get here. But the scripture says that God does not use evil to get his purpose done. So Joseph is saying, in his spirit, he knows that I got here, God's going to use me. It's a good thing God's going to use me. But you did me wrong, and I'm going to have to forgive you or kill you one of
them.
I'm not twisting it, the interpretation is, but God doesn't use the sin. So Joseph said, well, it did. Joseph said it must be right. I just going to tell him what's been going on. Verse 6.
For these 2 years have the famine been in the land, and yet there are 5 years in which there shall neither be a hearing nor harvest.
Okay, anybody ever seen a land of famine? Not you personally. Anybody ever seen a hungry land? Yeah. Brother McClellan, you was in Korea.
He said no TV.
I'm talking about first hand. Walk the streets, look at the people.
Real stuff.
There's something you don't want to see. People are eating tree bark. They eat rats, and that's it. They eat dog. They eat anything to stay alive. I happen to be stationed about maybe 15, 20 miles from the separation of those two countries. And it was bad. It was absolutely bad. That's what you call modern day. Famine means, and it also means that not only are they suffering, but some people are dying in groves from a lack of not being able to eat. It does bad to a people. I was at the boys' club the other day. One kid, they said that bullets is caused by nutritional deficiency. I wasn't very rich. But I seen a kid that was way out up here in North Tulsa. So it's devastating to a population. And so Joseph is telling them here that 2 years they have been famine in the land, and we got 5 more to go. And God sent me before you to preserve you a posterity in the earth and to save your lives by a great deliverance. Okay, God sent me before you to preserve and to save your lives by a great deliverance. So he says, God's going to use me, and that's one reason why I can forgive you. God's going to use me because there's some people behind me who God really wants to deliver. Yes?
But chapter 50 points that out.
Okay.
Genesis 15, okay. Well, the brother was afraid after the daddy died that Joseph was going to kill him now. And Joseph said unto them, fear not, for am I in the place of God? But as for you, you thought evil against me, but God did it unto good to bring it to pass, as it is this day, to save much people alive.
Yeah. So Joseph is saying, God's going to use this.
19.
So there could be some adversity in everybody's lives today that just is not adding up. But as long as you know God has a plan for your life, you can be assured that adversity has nothing to stop God's plan. We lay it. He's all sovereign. He's all knowing. It's not like, oh, that's a new surprise. I know that, brother. Oh, now what am I going to do? Oh, man. Adam said, oh, now what am I going to do? No, he's already got things coming. Got a plan worked out. The reality is that everybody don't know what the plan is. The devil had known the plan. He would not. Oh, no, you ain't going to that cross. You know, the devil had known the plan. So, no. And sometimes God is speaking straight to somebody, and it still goes right over their head what the plan is. Proceed to lose your head. What? Proceed. Say mercy. You don't know how it's going to happen, what to happen, but God can. So, all right, that's the good news there. Now, so according to the lesson, verse 8, so it was not you that sent me, hither. Joseph would have wound up in Egypt some kind of way. Some kind of way. He'd have had something going on with Pharaoh, some kind of way. It's obvious because he was dreaming before he got to Pharaoh, and he was still had that type of anointing on him when he was in prison. And he could have sent information to Pharaoh at any time, captive or free man. He could have got the revelation about what to do. So, but you're saying, hey, you still did me wrong. So now it was not you that sent me hither, but God. And he had made me a father to Pharaoh and lord of all his house. In other words, he had made me the main advisor to Pharaoh. He listens to me like a son does to his father. When I speak, I got his ear. He's giving me attention. I can rebuke him. Pharaoh is, I got it. He's under my control. He's going to listen to me. And over all his house, and a ruler throughout all the land of who? Egypt. Now, isn't that amazing? Check it out. A Hebrew in charge of what?
Everything in Egypt.
In Egypt. What we need to do today is just look up and say, hey, old sinner in charge of everything. That's the redemption side of the story. Because I think Pastor Hilton said the other week, all things are what?
Yes.
All. Very controlled. All of you. That's why you need to read Ephesians. Ephesians. Short air. In control with him. Work together with him. So we're in control. That's the redemption style flavor of this lesson. It's you in it too. So here I am, a Jew with all this power in the land of the Gentiles. Joseph is concerned about his father. Why is he concerned about his father, Israel? Known as Jacob. Why is he concerned about it? He hadn't seen Sister Hill in a long time. All of a sudden, he saw her and said, hey, guys, let's see. Hey, how's your sister who? Let's say if it's about 40 years from
now. Wouldn't be drinking. 40 years.
Why? How are they doing?
You know, one time he was a favorite son.
And he was a favorite son.
Yeah, he was.
He knows that a man is still alive.
Yeah.
Economic downturn. So, verse 9. Hey, she, go up to my father and say unto him, thus said thy son, tell him, my name is Joseph. God has made me Lord of all Egypt. How do you like to give that good news to your relatives? I'm vice president in charge of XYZ Corporation throughout all the world.
Everybody
will be happy. I'm the man in charge. I came in entry level.
Yeah.
I just came in as the janitor. Just barely got my foot in the door and got it before. But before you know it, I'm in the boardroom.
I'm making decisions.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah. So, go tell my father that. God has made me Lord of all Egypt. Come down to me and do what? Hurry up. Woo. Why hurry up? Go. Don't waste no time. Hurry up and get here. Hurry up and get here. Now, this is going to be a part of a prologue with our redemption in Christ. Is that when the whole now was the day of salvation, the day that you hear, hurry up. Hurry up. Because he wants you to share in the inheritance of what he's going to do for you. Hurry up. Okay. Now, let's look at some realities in verse 10. Someone read that if you will, please.
Thou shalt dwell in the land of Goshen. Mm-hmm. Thou shalt be near me, near unto me. Thou and thy children and thy children's children, and my flocks and my herds, and all that thou hast.
Yes, now Joseph could have put them anywhere. Mm-hmm. He could have had food traveling back and forth to them, but he says, come nigh. This is over, I believe, in the book of Ephesians. He's brought us nigh. He's torn down the wall of partition, things that separated us, and he's brought us close to him. That's the work that Jesus did. Here's Joseph doing a type of that kind of work. I want you to come close to me. I'm with the power, with the goods, with the authority. That's what Jesus is saying. Come, made us come nigh now. So now that I'm close, why are you bringing me close? Here we go.
This is also a testimony of the kind of authority they had been given to Joseph, because Pharaoh had, you know, later on Pharaoh did say, give him the best of the land of Egypt, but he had told him that yet.
He has that kind of authority. Pharaoh don't know nothing. He don't know the whole story. He don't know nothing what's going on. That's who Joseph did not tell the whole story to. Not tell the whole story to Pharaoh. His story. Pharaoh has no idea about Joseph's real, complete story. But Joseph is second in command. He's actually first in command. He's calling all the shots, making all the decisions, doing all the buying and selling. And he's doing good, doing all that he's doing. And he don't have such a nobody. And it's almost time for Christians to go ahead.
To the point, you know, what this tells me is that Joseph knew his authority. He had a full understanding of his authority, and if we got a full understanding of ours, we'd be calling some things that we not as though they were. Like, you can do it right here. You got that man over there, Joseph. I got that man over there. Think you have to understand it, and you don't, you're not really sure.
See, and Joseph said earlier that Pharaoh listens to me. I got wise counsel. I got the wisdom of God. You got to be assured that you're comfortable, that you got the wisdom of God. You know God's talking to you. You know God's word. I'm walking in the reality of what God's word is saying. And, well, I gotta go ask more five people, let me find the prophecies, well, I mean, evangelist too. What do you think about this?
Hey, go ahead, Mother Hill.
No, I was just gonna say, we do have the authority, and often we don't exercise it. Mm-hmm. But I think we do have to remember that in exercising authority in some realm, there is order.
Yeah.
We have to remember the order. We just can't abandon order and says, I got authority to do this, you know, that in some areas. We have to respect that.
Of course.
Well, why is Pharaoh listening to Joseph?
Why is he listening to Joseph? Because Joseph is bringing the goods.
I already know that. And that's the reason why he listened.
That's right. Joseph revealed that the Spirit of the Lord is upon him, and I'm going to not only save my people, I'm going to save the whole world.
But his naked eyes is sin. That's what sin is, but his faith ain't sin. That's the same thing with us.
Right.
Our naked eyes is sin, but we believe that. But if we can't see something, we're not going to believe it.
No, but Joseph could, because he's got divine inspiration.
Yeah, Joseph.
Pharaoh was a beneficiary.
Right, exactly.
And Joseph proved this to Pharaoh that he had the Spirit of God in him when he was able to interpret the dream. He said, none of his wives were supposed to.
Yeah, so all that other superficial stuff you've been relying on, Mr. Pharaoh, ain't been working for you.
Exactly.
Here's the deal. And those 7 years, look at all that you got. But guess what? We got 7 years that you're going to take some real divine management. And we're only in the 2 years of them. And Joseph has been operating. Now, I don't ask Pharaoh about nothing. Everything I do is by the inspiration, the grace, the wisdom of God. And it's proven what? Out. And Pharaoh was letting him run with it.
But do you think that was because God had given him favor with Pharaoh during the time that he interpreted the dream? Pharaoh had to turn up his trust.
Sure.
Into Joseph.
Sure.
To give him. Yeah,
sure. I think, can we comfortably say Pharaoh trusted Joseph more than he did his wife?
Yeah.
Oh, yes.
Yeah, I think he did.
At least one of the wives.
At least one of the wives.
So, yeah, I think so.
Pharaoh listened to Joseph about the son listening to what? His father. Well, when in Genesis 41, when he told Pharaoh, he told Pharaoh, you know, to appoint officers to do this, and told him, you know, what was going to happen. He told him to appoint just officers, none necessarily king. And from verse 37 says the thing was good in the eyes of Pharaoh and in the eyes of all his servants. And Pharaoh said to his servants, can we find such a one as this, a man who is the Spirit of God?
Yeah, so he knew he had something. Okay, verse 10, let's go through that right quick and get out of here. And thou shalt dwell in the land of Goshen, and thou shalt be near unto me, thou and thy children, and thy children's children, and thy flocks, and thy herds, and all that thou hast. And there will I nourish thee, for yet there are 5 years of famine. Least thou and thy household, all that thou hast, do what?
Come to poverty.
Jesus type says, come and get close to me. So you can stay away from what?
Poverty.
Because I'm going to nourish you. I'm going to fix you up. I'm going to give you the advantage. I'm going to do all of that good stuff so that you won't be poor. Now, why the land of Goshen? Goshen, whatever. Goshen. Why that
land? Fertile land.
It was good land. And it was a land that was less populated at that time. See, Joseph didn't travel throughout every place. And he knows the land of Egypt. He says the best place to put a bunch of Hebrews where there won't be no rats is over here in Goshen.
Yeah, because the Egyptians despised shepherds.
Yes.
They absolutely despised shepherds.
Because they weren't shepherds. This land is good for grazing or their occupation.
So come over here in this land, it's not that populated, and you won't be bothered that much. by all the Egyptians who might harass you just because you are Hebrew. It's a definite distinct difference in the peoples. Come over here, and I'm going to set you up over here, and I'm going to be close to you, and I can get to you back and forth, and all like that, and I can see you, and I can feed you. And guess what? When I broker some grain, and all like that, guess who's going to get there? That's the best. Brother Curtis is brokering some stuff, and his son's standing in line to get his portion. Does your son stand in the back of the line or front of the line, Brother Curtis? Middle of the line, maybe. Right here. Right here. Right here.
On the line.
Yeah, right here. Because you're just my people. Take care of my people. And that's what Joseph is doing. That's what the word is saying. Get nigh to Jesus so you can stay away from poverty.
Yes.
Hallelujah. Okay. Verse 4, 12, someone read it, please.
And behold, your eyes see, and the eyes of my brother Benjamin, that it is my mouth that speaketh unto you.
I know this is amazing to you, but you can see I'm the man. Can't you see I'm the man? It's me. Can't you see? This is me saying this. Wow. What if we can just get a little muscle and some courage? Let's call him his shots. All right. Now, and you shall tell my father of all my glory. Whose glory? Joseph's glory. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Tell him how I got it going on over here in Egypt. Now, Jesus at one time, and I'm got the scripture, St. John 1 and 12, he came into his own. His own deceived them not. Jesus trying to tell folks, his own people, I got it going on. Oh, how God has anointed me. Look what I can do. Look how many people getting healed by my ministry, the teaching I'm doing. And his own people get what? Here's a type of Jesus. Joseph says, go tell them what I got going on. I like that because you go tell Kim, Rocky and them, go tell them that we got it going. I'm going over here with old Northside.
Well, I don't know.
We're getting there.
We got it. Hold on. And you tell them, you see me coming out of my mouth? Go tell them I got it going on. Come over here and let's get blessed. So you should tell my father of all my glory in Egypt and all that you have seen, and you should hurry up and bring down my father here. Okay, and he fell upon his brothers, and this is the reconciliation. He fell upon his brother's Benjamin's neck and did good. I think when I first read this in the Bible, I cried.
Yeah.
And Benjamin wept upon his neck. Moreover, he kissed all his brethren, and everybody cried on it. Kind of like he stood on to the throne
snide. You don't see me
doing
that now.
Throwing snide. Jesus, come to Jesus' home.
Don't do that now.
Please, go to Genesis 45. Let's go. Before we close out, go to Genesis 45, 16 through 21. 16 through 21. Okay. Now, this is why didn't Joseph tell Pharaoh the whole story? And the fame thereof was heard in Pharaoh's house, saying, Joseph's brethren are come. And it pleased Pharaoh well and his servants. Pharaoh said unto Joseph, saying to thy brethren, this do ye, lay the beast, or lad the beast, and go and get into the land of Canaan. And take your father and your households and come unto me, and I will give you the what? And you shall eat the what? Now thou art commanded, this do ye, take your wagons out of the land of Egypt for your little ones and for your wives, and bring your father and come. Also, regard not your stuff, for the good of all of the land of Egypt is whose?
Yours.
You sinners, you slave sellers, guess what you got now? All the land of Egypt. But after you've been forgiven and we're reconciled, we cry and we kiss and we make it up and all that. And the children of Israel, verse 21, did so. And Joseph gave them wagons according to the commandment of Pharaoh and gave them provisions for the way. Joseph never did tell Pharaoh the whole story. Why don't you talk about that? After this, they don't talk about that. Why? Because in forgiveness, reconciliation, and redemption, there is no more mention of what? You forgive somebody, you reconcile, there's no more mention of what? The only people bringing it up is the devil.